Hi everyone, you've probably already heard of machine learning. As you know, machine learning algorithms are powerful tools that produce predictions. We'll see here a specific model widely used in many fields that seems to be a good starting point to understand the intuitions behind machine learning algorithms. That simple model can be understood visually, it is based on simple concepts, and it is a building block of more complex models. Let me take you through a demystifying walk among decision trees. Let's start this journey gently. Before going for a walk among trees, we need some equipment. Let's first define what data, a model, or a prediction are, and once well equipped, we'll go on this adventure. Let's learn with an example. Here is a dataset that summarizes some characteristics of students in mathematics, with their name, family situation, the number of absences or hours of study time, as well as their average grade for the year and whether they passed or not. Each line of this table is what we call an observation, and the set of all accessible observations is our data. With this data, we can build a model that can predict the final grade of students based on their characteristics. And in order to do this, we will have to find a link or a formula linking the individual characteristics of the students to their final grade. This formula is a model. The individual characteristics are the explanatory variables, or covariates or features, and the grade to predict is the target variable, or the outcome. A simple example of a model is linear regression. Indeed, if we plot the final grades of 10 students against their first semester results, we can see that there is a clear link. We can thus draw the line that passes through the middle of all these points. We can see that this modeling is not perfect. We make mistakes. Sometimes the final grade of a student will be above the line, sometimes below. And when I say through the middle, what I mean is that this line must minimize these mistakes. But even with this imperfect model, we can easily get an idea of the expected grade for a new student. A student who would have received a grade of 5 in the first semester can expect a final grade of about 6.1. A student who got 20 can expect a grade of about 19.9. The idea is not to find a perfect, more complex model that would make fewer or no mistakes. The latter model, which arguably makes no errors on the 10 students used to build it, however, predicts the grade of 175 to Alice, who had obtained 4 in the first semester, 14.7 to Bob, having obtained 14.5, and minus 18,000 to poor Charlie, who had previously obtained 20. In summary, the predictive quality of a model is not equal to its complexity. A model that is too simple may miss essential information, while a more complex model will not be able to generalize its results to observations that were not used in its construction. And if we clearly cannot have both, we want to find a compromise between accuracy and generalization ability. And this is the crucial idea of machine learning. Let's go back to our data and divide it in two. A large part of our data goes on one side, a smaller part on the other. We will build our model on the data in the training set and evaluate it on the testing set. Okay. We've said a lot and we're still barely scratching the surface of our topic. So maybe this is a good time to summarize what we've learned so far. You can think of a model as a box. It is built with training data and validated on test data. Once this box is built, we can give it input variables to get predictions about our target output variable. And if our previous model was simple to understand, it is in fact rarely the case, and it's often very difficult in practice to understand what's going on in those boxes. That's why, when we can't, we often refer to them as black boxes. Of course, there are many models. Simple ones, robust ones, some more elegant than others, some more interpretable. We will focus here on a model that I find elegant, visual, and understandable. We'll talk about decision trees. This is a decision tree. From a graph theory point of view, it is a special kind of graph, that is, a set of nodes, the circles, connected together by edges. A decision tree has to be a connected graph, in other words, in one piece. It must not contain any cycle, and from each of the nodes must start three edges. Except for one node that we call root, and for the terminal nodes that we call leaves. Let's rearrange this tree a bit. Here it is. The nodes resulting from the division are the child nodes of the top level node, the parent node. Let's add decision rules to each node in the tree, except for the leaves. And that's it. As we said, this is a decision tree. But what does it have to do with prediction? Let's go back to our example with the student's grade. Remember? First, let's simplify it, and instead of trying to predict the final grade, let's try to predict whether the students will pass their exam or not. In other words, whether their final grade will be above or equal to 10. Let's take into account other variables in our data, such as the number of past class they failed, or if students have private lessons at home, for instance. What is then the fate of Elise predicted by the decision tree? Just start with the root. Has Elise failed a class in the past? No. In that case, let's follow the left branch. Does she have the chance to have private lessons? No also. Let's go to the left branch. There's the prediction for Elise. She is expected to pass her final exam. We even have a kind of confidence level for that prediction, 70%. The tree here is very simple and uses rules that depend on only two variables. If we represent in the plane all the possible combinations taken by these two variables, with red dots for the students who failed their exam, and green ones for those who passed. It is interesting to see that this tree corresponds in fact to a partitioning of this plane. Let us look at that. First, the tree separates the students who never failed the class from the others. Then, among the students who never did, the tree separates those who have had extra support from those who have not. Indeed, we can see that this partitioning of the plane separates the student well according to their exam result. If the characteristics of a new student fall in this region, we predict a failure. Here, a success. And as we've seen, Alice must be represented somewhere around here. And there is a perfect correspondence between the plane and the tree. We could even say that they represent exactly the same thing in two different forms. And that's how to read the decision tree. Now we can dive into a more complex question. How do we choose the splitting rules? In other words, how to split a node? The challenge of this step is capital. We must find for each parent node the division rule that will allow us to divide our observations between the two child nodes in the best possible way and yield good predictions. Let's visualize this with dots. Each dot represents a student from our training dataset. The green dots represent the students who passed their exam, the red dots, well, the others. Intuitively, if the split allows to totally separate the observations, then the rules that allow this division is perfect, and any new observation would have a clear prediction. If it falls in the left node, then it's an observation that sure behave like all the observations of the left node, and we predict that the student will pass his exam. On the contrary, if it had fallen in the right node, we would have predicted a failure for this observation. On the other hand, if now the division rule distributes the dots like this, we will still be able to make predictions, of course, but with less confidence. Intuitively, we want to be able to choose splits that produce the purest possible child nodes. In other words, we want the observations in each node to be as homogeneous as possible. To do this, we need to be able to measure the purity of a node. In an interesting and completely equivalent way, it is rather a measure of impurity that we will look for. It would be a measure that would be at its maximum if the node is very inhomogeneous. That is, if it contains as many green dots as red ones. And that would be equal to zero if the node is pure, meaning that it contains only dots of the same color. Indeed, if for each node we were able to measure its impurity given a split rule, we would only have to test every single one of them. Then, we could choose the split that minimizes the mean impurity of the child nodes. Well, not just any mean, but the mean weighted by the number of observations in each node. As you can guess, in our prediction problem, it is clear that we give more weight to the impurity of the node that represents more students. We especially care for the purity of bigger nodes. In other words, in order to split a given node, we have to find a split that minimizes this. The average of the impurities of each child node, weighted by the proportion of observations ending in each node. And good news, we can easily define such impurity measures. In classification, we commonly use the Gini index, for example, or the entropy. Even if these different measures can lead to slightly different divisions, and therefore trees, the idea is the same. The more the proportion of a class in a node is important, the lower the value of the function. Conversely, if the proportions are close, the impurity value is maximal. With our training data, we can start from the root and find the best division rule to build the next nodes. Then we can do the same thing with the next nodes and divide them as well, and so on until the end of time. Really? No, of course not. No tree grows to the sky. There are obvious stopping rules that prevent the tree from growing more. First, if a node is perfectly pure and contains only one type of observation, well, no need to divide it further. One can also specify other arbitrary rules, like setting a maximum depth or a minimum number of observations in each leaf, for instance. Anyway, by splitting the tree as many times as we can and respecting those rules, we can build a very deep tree, which we call a maximal tree. But is the maximal tree really a good model? Remember the model we built at the beginning of the video? We have shown that complexifying a model makes it more accurate on training data, but much less so on new data. A model that is too simple is not very accurate, but a model that is too complex cannot generalize. Our maximal tree is literally the equivalent of this model. It fits the training data perfectly, but would be unable to produce good prediction on the testing set. Again, we've truly learned a lot, and I don't want to spend too much time on the details. All you need to know is that we do have an efficient method that allows to find a compromise between the predictability of the tree on the training set and its complexity. We can finally test this model on our test data set. Remember? That's data that we're not used to grow this tree. For those students, let's see what's predicted by the tree compared to the truth. As you can see, given our test data, our tree makes the right prediction 72% of the time. Not bad, don't you think? As we can see, a decision tree is a rather easy model to build, but also to understand. It gives, for example, insights on the important variables for our model. Indeed, if a variable appears high in the tree, it can be considered important. Of course, there is a lot to say on this subject, and there are many other ways to obtain the importance of variable for a decision tree. I just wanted to point out that, unlike many other models, the famous black boxes mentioned earlier, here the model is transparent and there is no need for more transformations or analysis to understand what is done and what is important. We immediately see that having already failed other classes must be an important information to predict whether the students will fail or not. Same goes for the study time, for instance. On the other hand, this model also has its limits. First, the method of building a tree is what's called a greedy process. This means that an optimization is done at each node, so we can be sure that each division taken independently of the others is the best possible. But this does not guarantee that the overall tree is the best possible. The optimization is done by looking at one step in advance and without looking at all the steps in total. Then, and it's probably the most limiting point, even a slight alteration of the training dataset causes significant changes in the structure of the final tree. We say that a decision tree is an unstable model. This is annoying because a property that a model should have is robustness. A very slight perturbation of the input data should only slightly modify the final model. But as annoying as it seems, we can easily find various solutions to this problem. But, well, here's a good place to stop, I guess. There are still loads of things that we could say on tree-based models. We could talk about random forests, or tree boosting, or even survival or longitudinal trees, and all of those could have their own videos. But my goal is not to overwhelm you with that here. I simply hope that you got my point. Tree-based models are not that hard to understand, and the mechanisms to build a tree are rather natural in a sense. Beyond that, I found them to be a great excuse to introduce broader topics like machine learning or even simply modelization. If you enjoyed this video or found it instructive, do not hesitate to like and share it. And if not, well, at least we've enjoyed this nice walk among trees together.